We're gathered here at Phase 3 reunion again. Unfortunately, Gary's not with us today. However, we have the important guys that we want to interview about the 1969 New Year's Eve coming back from Hanover in the snow in Jeff's Vauxhall.
No, I
Viva.
Look.
Viva. You got it.
So,
yes, we have ordered our meal, and we'll come back later and interview each guy individually, okay? And standing in for Gary, who wasn't there, it doesn't matter, is Anthony Pecker.
Okay.
Yeah, there he is.
That's Anthony Pecker.
Okay, now, you probably experienced a little whiplash on this, but it's young lady, please tell us who you are.
My name's Brooke. I work at the Hoover.
You are our waitress for today.
Yes, I'm a server.
Thank you. And I'm sure you're going to do it for me.
It's going to go viral. I hope you don't mind this.
Lucky you.
I'm blessed. Thank you.
Okay. If you'd known that, you'd have put on darker lipstick.
I would have too.
East Quebec, and then you hit the Labrador border.
Okay, yeah.
And then you
fucking. The highway kind of ends somewhere around the.
Yeah, yeah. So we fired up. But boy,
is that.
When they talk about barren, they're not kidding.
Yeah.
Wow, Labrador is barren. Why would anybody want to live here is beyond me. But holy cow.
Oh, I lived in Saskatchewan, so.
Yeah.
With it very much.
Well, you can curl at least, right?
Yeah. That's right.
A lot of curling.
Mixed drunk and curling.
I work with a guy from Saskatchewan. He was a big curler.
Yep. They all are up there.
Yeah. Nothing else to do.
That's right.
Yes. She also said, and be careful because it's raining, and that's the most dangerous time on the Trans-Canada. It's not ice and snow that they worry about, it's water. And the reason being is because they still have studded tires. And the studded tires have created these ruts in the Trans-Canada, and the water sits in there. And we saw two cars in the ditch on the way on Buena Vista, and it was perfectly dry. Like, I couldn't figure out. I mean, it was a little bit wet, but it wasn't that bad. But apparently, that's a dangerous part of driving.
It's
a noise. It's a water.
Well, Mitch and I can tell you about 40 degrees below. Right, Mitch?
Below. Yeah, Jordan and I in January of 1972 drove from Kitchener to Regina. So we figured we'd go through the states because we could, we wouldn't be
warmer down there.
So basically, Chicago headed north. It was you could hear the reports talking about the temperature dropping.
Chicago, Minneapolis. Into North Dakota.
Well, we did cross back into Manitoba and hit Winnipeg, and we had to fill up the car. Now, we had to fill up before we got there, but we filled up again. It was so cold, we didn't turn the car
off
while
we
were filling it. Filling the gas.
That's against the law.
Minus 60.
In a Rambler Classic.
In a Rambler Classic.
Yeah. And the last stretch we did from midnight to 6 in the morning on the Trans-Canada in that Rambler.
Did you put the piece of cardboard in front of the radiator?
I believe we did.
Yes, we did.
Yes, we did. The radiator, and then you actually get some heat in the car.
Yeah.
They don't make cars for Saskatchewan with that built right in, that cardboard
built
right in.
Well, actually, lots of people have
the
Naugahyde one that clips that goes on the front of the grill.
Oh, nice.
Oh, yeah.
Is that called a nose bra?
With two little holes in it with little turnbuckles so you could open the two little flaps on the front to let it
go. Just so you don't overheat the engine.
Yeah. On a slightly warmer day when it's only minus 30, you open the flaps.
And this is the Rambler when you got to, it was in Minnesota, the distributor went on it.
Yeah.
So they abandoned the car in Minnesota, flew home, and I had to go over there with the distributor and put the car back in shape and drive it home.
We did not abandon the car.
You abandoned it.
No. The car, why could we not fix it?
Was that Pete's car?
No.
No.
Do you know why?
It
was a Canadian built Rambler. And we were in the States, they couldn't get a part for it.
Could have shipped a part over.
And we, back in those days, we didn't have credit cards.
No.
We
had $13 in the pocket.
We were 1,000 miles from home.
So you abandoned this Rambler.
We're 1,000 miles. Well, the service station.
You abandoned it. You came home and made me go get it.
Yes, but it wasn't reckless abandon. It was organized abandon. I mean,
it wasn't abandoned.
It was at a
parking
spot.
We parked it. We parked it.
At a service.
And we stored it.
It was all based on the.
It's like an old girlfriend. You just dropped her off and never saw her again. You didn't abandon her, you just parked
it. But it was all based on the assumption, Pete will take care of it, right?
Yeah.
But Pete, George, we got back.
Lucky
George, what did the part cost? $3?
Something like that.
And then Pete.
It was a
couldn't ship it over. over and had to fix it.
Was it a rotor? A rotor?
Yeah, for the distributor. Rotor. Yeah. The distributor.
Actually, it cost you $3.
And I'm not sure, you know, we had no money, and we got
you
we hitchhiked 500 miles.
No, they couldn't get it.
From
it was a Canadian built.
I think I took a whole distributor with me because I think the bearing made.
We hitchhiked 500 miles from Minneapolis to Chicago, and then we had enough money to buy a bus ticket from Chicago to Kitchener. Otherwise, we didn't have anything.
We met these guys at the where we quotation marks abandoned the car. There were three guys going to a convention in Chicago, and
they were going to Alabama, but they were going through Chicago.
Oh, through Chicago, okay.
A poultry conference.
We'll get you to Chicago. So we got to Chicago.
Their names were Paul Waldner and Solomon Mandel.
Oh my God.
What were they wearing?
Holy cow. and they had something to do with chickens.
And what were they wearing, George?
They were dressed Mennonite-ish.
Really?
Ish. Yeah. Ish. We were fortunate that they got us to Chicago. Otherwise, we would have had to phone home and say, can you wire us some money because we didn't have enough.
I guess you could get the part.
Canadian-American and American-American
are not the same thing. Part number in Canada and the States. Different number. If you knew what the American part number was, you could probably get it.
That was 72.
At least it didn't have Buck 98 tires on it.
That's true.
We didn't have computers in 72, I guess.
Truck was good until some guy put a stage in.
Mike, do you remember the $1.98 tires on it?
I do.
And what happened there?
We bought two of them. Not just one, two $1.98 tires.
They really $1.98.
No, that was what Mike said.
No, they were recaps and they were fine as long as they were overloaded, but you exceeded the load of the vehicle.
But we had built the stage. Heavy duty transport tires that we put on.
Like truck tires.
Looking back, he's saying, but we knew nothing.
All I can say is I'm sure glad I wasn't there.
Speaking about Mark,
that guy, when we got to the gig, he gave us a lot of trouble. He was mad at us.
Words to that effect.
That's when the transmission, the drive shaft fell out.
I like pulling out the bumper.
That was fun.
Our first TV, the first one.
Gary was
ready to jump. We're going to die.
Gary was ready to jump.
We're going to die.
But we won't mention burning rubber in reverse. And
screw Pete. He goes down with the bus.
Poor Charles.
Wasn't it 175 or 335? Same one as BB King, right?
Yeah, 345.
Very nice. 345. I don't know, was that one from East End or no?
No, I was from Trev. I bought it from Trev.
Because Trev gave you a deal.
No.
He said he did, but he didn't. Okay.
I was talking about Fat Mike.
Have you priced those nowadays? You know what they're worth?
The old ones? I looked at a 1969 335.
Yeah.
At the Folkways here in Waterloo.
Mm-hmm.
And they wanted $37,000 for it or something. Yeah. Wow.
Really?
Wow.
You remember the guy who was the proprietor at East End? What do they call it? East End?
Fat Mike,
East End Appliances.
Yeah, and...
Mike Ekonomov.
I was telling Patrick about him last night, because I was telling him we were buying the Gibson organ there, and knew which one he wanted, and we knew he could get a better price and went down. I think
all the time you're buying this organ, you say, boogie-tie. They use it as a live music venue in connection with Studio Bell and the National Music Center, which is also the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, the Country Music Hall of Fame. It's all
in.
So when they opened up, they had a group in there from Vancouver, they're called Petunia and the Vipers. Great band. Petunia's a guy.
Yeah.
But one of the things he does in addition to singing and working and doing some roots kind of country stuff is he does a fair bit of yodeling.
Oh, yes.
just a wild ride.
Yeah.
Wild ride. We ever get a chance to see Petunia and the Vipers, it's worth it.
Well, it's very interesting.
I'm not big into yodeling personally.
We went there, and of course, there's no tables left or anything.
In context.
Ended up sitting around a pole or something. Mm-hmm. So everybody seems to leave but the guy that was sitting beside me and me, right? And he turns around to me and he says, "Who'd you come to see?" And I said, "Oh, Petunia and the Vipers." And he looks at me and he said, "Pardon? You came to see them?" I said, "Yeah, why?" And he couldn't find a way to say, "You're too old."
No.
Okay, so what he said was, "Well, my wife and uncle's in the band, so all the band members came over."
Good. Oh, nice.
So that was kind of interesting. Yeah.
Good stuff. Very strange. Petunia is like not quite a tiny tune sort of guy.
No. Oh, yeah. Oh, that would be worth it.
Of the same genus.
George and I went to see Tiny Tim one time. I think it was at, was it Bingaman's?
Cornet.
Tiny Tim at
Tiny Tim?
Yeah.
I think George got his autograph.
No, you know who was backing up Tiny Tim? Mitch, you can guess who was backing up Tiny Tim. Yeah, Joe Panic and his wonderful, wonderful orchestra. Joe Panic is Craig Hart.
So. Yeah, it seems to me I remember Craig talking about he backed up a lot of guys at Lulu's too.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, he backed up Jerry and Lulu's.
Well, when you did COE, did you end up taking over as a resident organist from Randy Rollo or something?
No,
because he used to do that gig all the time.
No, what happened though was we met the agent from Detroit, and he's the one who booked us, meeting Craig, and he booked us.
Okay.
The Hall of the Annie gigs in the States, so that came out of that. We needed a drummer, so we had hired Kurt for that, but we went out as a duo.
I think Randy Rollo's son's playing.
Ben Rollo's playing. He's very good.
Yeah,
they tend to do gigs at Rockaway Senior Center.
Yeah, and he's done some stuff at the Registry.
We go to the Registry. George, you were there for Randy. No, you were there for Paul Hawk.
I've seen a few videos of Paul Hawk.
Yeah.
Kids who did at Rockaway Senior
Center. I didn't realize that Paul Hawk was an usher at Bill Ray's wedding.
Really?
How did you learn that?
Actually, shortly after, I was over at Bill's house, and he pulled out an old photograph when he and Joan got married. He was talking about the usher, and it was Paul Hawk. I said, Paul, you see, I'm Paul Hawk. My good friends, he played piano and blah. I said, I just saw him a couple weeks ago, playing at the Senior Center. I said, he's actually pretty good.
Oh, well.
Carries a tune nicely. Not bad on the keyboards.
I remember, I think I was in the back seat, and we were somewhere near Listowel, heading back towards Kitchener-Waterloo. And we all saw the snow bank that was there. And I thought, okay, he's not slowing down for it. He's going to run it. I just sort of braced a little bit for impact. And we hit it, and I remember doing a 180. We're in the wrong lane going backwards down the highway, and we came to a... No? Okay, Pete has a different recollection.
That's all right.
Anyway,
we'll get all the recollections.
We were going backwards.
Yes.
Okay. And then the car stopped, and we all started to laugh, actually, and somebody said, we could have been killed. And one thing for sure, I did not tell my parents. Nor did I tell them about the trips to Durham and that, when we had one guy standing out of the truck looking for the side of the road in the snowstorms. But that was it. We survived, and we're just thankful we did.
Okay, now we have to get Jeff's version.
Most about it is hitting this snowbank. No, I can't miss it. Might as well see if we can plow through it because I don't want to go sideways. So we go straight through it, and of course the car decided to switch ends. So my immediate thought was, how the hell do I keep going here, steering? I got to look through the back window. Okay, so turn around, start steering. Then I'm yelling at these guys, get your bloody heads down so I can see what the hell I'm going. Lie down. They're all going, we're all going to die. Get down.
And that's what you remember.
That was fine.
We actually came to a stop in our own lane backwards.
Yes.
Drove forward to the tow truck. Exchanged a few pleasantries.
Had to explain.
Did a turnaround and kept on going.
Wondered.
Yeah.
Okay. Good.
But had somebody been coming the other way, it would have been.
Oh yeah, that would have been bad. Mm.
So.
This is what I remember.
The pocket saver.
We're coming back from Hanover. It's the day after the snowstorm, I guess. It's New Year's Day. And Mitch and I are in the back seat. Jeff's driving. Pete's in the front seat. The farmer has plowed out his lane and dumped the snow in the middle of the highway. Two-lane highway. And we hit that pile of snow, and we do a 3.180. Mm. And as we're doing the 3.180, it happened so fast that I did not have a chance to be afraid. I didn't.
Or pray.
It would just happen so fast. We do this 3.180. I'm looking and say, oh, there's no oncoming traffic. Well, that's good. And then we wind up going in the right direction. We're going down the highway, the lane.
Backwards.
Yes, we're facing the wrong way, but we're going in the right direction.
True enough. Yes.
You know, and as we go by,
just facing the wrong direction.
As we go by these guys with the tow truck, everybody's pointing at us and we're waving. And, I mean, I didn't have a chance to get frightened. So that's my recollection.
Okay, here we are with my good friend Pete Sharman. And I want to thank you, Pete, for doing this quick video. No, yeah, because I messed up the other day at Hoothers, and we don't have your take on the return from Hanover on New Year's Day 1969 when we hit the snowbank in the middle of the highway. Just take it away and tell us what your memories are of that day.
My memory of that day, four of us in Jeff's Vauxhall Viva. That would be you and Mitch in the back and Jeff and I in the front. We're coming down the highway and we get to an area where the farmer had plowed out his lane and left a nice bank down across the highway. So Jeff didn't have time to stop for it, so he hit it and upon impact turned the car around 180 degrees. As it spun around, I remember very quickly scanning everything with a peripheral to see if anybody was coming. I saw the highway was clear, so I was fine. Not worrying, the most we could do is hit a snowbank. And Jeff managed to keep the car in the backwards moving position and get it back into the lane. And as we're in that lane, we pass a tow truck who is picking up a broken down car. And we passed him in the correct lane, going backwards. And we're all just looking out the window as if we're just sightseeing. And this fellow looks over and does a double take. Couldn't believe what he just saw. Jeff brings it to a stop, puts it in forward gear. We drive back up on the wrong side next to the tow truck, look out the window and say, slippery, and turn around and we go back home again. And that was about it.
Well, I thank you.
I'm surprised I can remember anything from that far back.